Chapter 39, The Coup, September 2004. On the 19th floor of the federal building on Golden Gate Avenue, girlfriends and wives whispered in the back row of Judge Charles Breyer's courtroom. At the defense tables, eight NF generals and captains in red jumpsuits chatted and laughed easily with their lawyers. A line of U.S. Marshals stood behind them. The general known as Tibbs laughed the loudest, as if he hadn't a care in the universe, and his smile was broad and breezy. The Operation Black Widow defendants had spent 4 years awaiting a trial that had yet to take place in this room. Month after month and motion after motion, the case slogged along. With 21 co-defendants and myriad plea deals, it had taken years to whittle Black Widow down to these eight. They were the men at the top of the NF, the last to go down, and they'd make it known they would never take a deal. Attorney General John Ashcroft, too, had told his prosecutors around the country that there should be no more plea agreements in criminal cases. The doors flew open and a dozen men in dark suits stormed into the court. These additional marshals moved into a military pattern eerily similar to the movements of NF carnales when they protected their own on the yard. Additional marshals arranged themselves behind each defendant while another group dispersed along the walls. All stood with legs spread, hands clasped in front. Two more stood in the doorway. No one was leaving Judge Breyer's courtroom. Though he'd spent so much of his recent years in Breyer's court, Rico was not among the NF brass that day. Well into spring, John Ashcroft continued to hold out for the death penalty. But there was a lot the Attorney General didn't know about his case. Rico's federal defender made sure that U.S. Attorney Kevin Ryan and his prosecutor, Stephen Gruhl, learned all about Mueller's morally questionable order to wait for more overt acts before Shorty was killed. The Salinas cop on the case testified to the grand jury about it. Under oath, the officer said the cops made no arrest while the murder plot unfolded because prosecutors wanted more. The officer didn't say which prosecutors. Some tried to point the finger at Olvis and Ham. To clear up the confusion, Olvis declared to a judge that the order came not from the Monterey County District Attorney, but the U.S. Attorney General's office, Mueller's office. The transcript was placed under seal, but Rico's lawyer had the declaration transcript in hand, and he milked it for leverage. The attorney then dug up more compromising information. He found out the Salinas cop, John Gunter, the man who famously offered Matt Rocha a drink, was having an affair with Rico's defense investigator and had even reviewed evidence for the case against Rico in the lobby of the evidence room with her. They'd also been to the crime scene. The lawyer dragged Gunter into the front of Judge Breyer, where he said under oath that he might have been romantically involved with the investigator before they ended up in the evidence room together. More important, police records showed Gunter was the last person to check out a box of evidence that was supposed to contain the sole copy of a crucial tape, the only police interview of Shorty made in the hospital the day after he was shot. Also, inexplicably missing was the record of an eavesdrop conversation in which Rico was said to have incriminated himself an hour before Shorty's murder. The tape later surfaced, and an evidence officer said it had been misplaced and had never left the evidence room. These revelations apparently didn't hurt Gunner's relationship because he eventually married his girl, but they did offer Ryan, Gruhl, and Ashcroft a high probability of being supremely embarrassed in the court of public opinion. Rico's lawyer leveraged every bit of it to his advantage, and the result was that Ashcroft's death penalty magically disappeared. But Ham and Olvis worked it too. They weren't willing to let Rico escape death without easing Salinas' PD unsolved caseload. In this, they found help from a most experienced source. In Judge Breyer's courtroom, the defense attorneys buzzed. The usually stern prosecutor, Stephen Gruhl, smiled and chatted breezily with the other side. The leader known as Cuete was unchained from the floor. He rose and, with five marshals marching behind him, stood before the judge. His lawyer announced he was changing his plea to guilty. Then Tibbs rose, and his entourage approached the bench. One by one, each of the Nuestra Familia's brass stood and, with the lawyers and marshals in tow, approached Judge Breyer. Each man's attorney read a guilty plea. Each defendant pleaded to one count of criminal racketeering, a charge that Gruhl explained included conspiracy and murder, specifically the murders of Michael Castillo and Vincent Sanchez, Mondo's friend. When they were done, the judge spoke. For the record, he said the goal of the case had been to take the gang's leaders out of California's prisons and to disperse them to the four corners of federal jurisdiction. "I am no expert," he said gravely, "but I hope that the Federal Bureau of Prisons will be able to curtail or eliminate the level of gang activity." The guilty pleas, he added, were the only dispositions that made sense, but he seemed wary of the outcome and offered a rare and cynical assessment of the case. "It seems to be seen, ultimately, whether this prosecution was warranted in the long run," he said. And that was it. Nearly a decade of investigations, wiretaps, and grand juries, then scores of arrests and millions spent, all came to this. The final eight gang leaders went down in quiet pleas. On the way out of the courtroom, a confused reporter asked a defense lawyer what the hell just happened. "Oh, they just wanted to help their friends a little," the attorney said. He explained that the generals had insisted any admission of guilt was contingent on Burr and two other captains each getting only 10 years. The lawyer grabbed his cell phone from a basket next to the metal detector and rushed down the hall. It was brilliant, a work of elegant choreography as smooth as the marshal's noiseless steps. It was a play worthy of leaders accustomed to striking at enemies in silent, certain motions. Under the agreements, the top three generals and two captains would stick with the life sentences long ago handed to them by the state, but they do their final time in federal prisons instead of California, and even trade. The clincher was that in less than 6 years, Byrd and another captain would be free, able to run the family's business in Salinas, Santa Rosa, Modesto, and the rest of Northern California. A third captain, a carnal from Salinas named Stork, had to finish a brief state sentence before serving his 10-year Fed term, but he would too be released before you knew it. The Feds, caught between a rock and another very hard rock, had little choice but to concede to this devil's deal. They couldn't afford to put Lizard on the stand for the defense to skewer, and the gang leaders had worked his weakness skillfully. The generals had just initiated a plan to ensure the NF would rise again, not only in California, but possibly throughout the federal prisons. For the first time in its 30-year history, the NF would go national. Shortly before the eight took their pleas, Rico had faced another judge in Salinas court. His appearance in his old stomping grounds prompted another high security detail. A deputy guarded the entrance to Judge Stephen Silman's court throughout the hearing, while eight more bailiffs stood outside. Rico appeared in dark plastic sunglasses and a red jumpsuit to face a new murder charge. It wasn't Moe or Lizard or Chico who'd put him here. Rico's right-hand man, the friend whose brush with death Rico worked so hard to avenge, had turned on him. The day Lobo decided he had enough of the NF, he told the FBI about his own role in Sal's murder, as well as all he knew about his homeboy Rico and the Michael hit. He didn't know much about Michael, and Lobo's role in Sal's death was far greater than Rico's. What nailed Rico was that damn robbery. Lobo had told the FBI that twice Rico had told him he killed a guy on the 123 market back in 1998. Rico kept telling Lobo it wasn't supposed to happen, but it did. Standing before Judge Silman and without removing his black shades, Rico did not speak except to enter his no contest plea. Chuck Olvis, however, did speak. He said Rico was admitting to the first-degree murder of a man who owned a small market in East Salinas. Ramesh was killed 6 years earlier in January 1998, the same year Michael and Shorty would have been whacked. It was one of those random crimes no one believed would ever be solved, a masked gunman in a convenience store. Ramesh was an Indian immigrant who taught himself Spanish to better serve his Salinas customers, and he was well known for allowing struggling families to take food on credit. He understood he, too, had come from poverty. For years, loyal customers knew Ramesh only as Tony because the first store he bought was called Tony's Market. He bought the 123 Market on New Year's Eve in 1998. The equipment was old and he planned to drive to a San Jose electronics store to buy a new register. 10 days after he signed the papers, his 16-year-old son was working with him when two men in ski masks burst in. Ramesh knew better than to resist. He reached for the register, but he wasn't familiar with the equipment, and it was hard to get the drawer open. One of the robbers grew impatient and upset. This was taking too long. The gunman shot Ramesh right before his young son's eyes. Rico provided no details during plea negotiations. He copped to first-degree murder but did not cooperate. Despite his dislike of the press, he took pains to make sure that particular fact was publicized in the papers, because whenever you took a deal, you had to make damn sure the familia didn't suspect you of ratting. Ham and Ovis scored a few additional victories with the arrangement. Rico also agreed to plead no contest to charges of attempting to murder Copas, attempting to murder Shorty's girlfriend, and to voluntary manslaughter in the death of Shorty. If for some unforeseen reason the feds couldn't pull off a long term, the state at least had him nailed for 49 years to life. Rico had beaten the man so many times. For years, he skated while others took the rap. He plotted elaborate hits, leading his crew the way a conductor leads an orchestra. And yet, his fall came from none of that. It was this little grocery store robbery and a few words uttered in confidence to a close friend. Satisfied that the people of Salinas would at least be free of Rico's tyranny, Ovis and Ham handed him back to U.S. Attorney Kevin Ryan, who followed their act by getting Rico to accept life without parole in federal prison. It wasn't death, but it was the best Ryan could hope for under the circumstances. The generals didn't seem bothered by Rico's fall. In their scheme of things, it was a big win. Rico could deploy before them and scout out the federal system. His destination would be to the United States Penitentiary in Pawlak, Louisiana. For the first time in his life, Rico would leave his wife and family far behind. From now on, the NF was his only family and the federal prison system was his only home. He could chalk it up as both a loss and a win. It was true, the man finally got him, but even in defeat, he scored his most impressive victory against the system. This time, Rico beat death itself.